morning again. So the Ten Commandments, this is week three of our four-week series, and last week was on the relationship, remember, that we have between us and God, and so now we begin looking at the relationship we have with each other. So the first, I want to share with you the Exodus reading, if you have that. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against a neighbor. So, question for you. Are these Ten Commandments, of which we have a smattering here, are these the code that we should try to live by? Should we try to live by these? What if I said no? Would that upset any of you, that if I said no, that is not? Now, before you get too upset, let me try to bring Paul to my side of the equation here and see if he can help us out. So in Romans chapter 3, Paul says, no human being will be justified in God's sight by keeping the law, by keeping the Ten Commandments. Instead, Paul says, through the law comes the knowledge of sin. So the Ten Commandments aren't intended even for something that we try to live by, and by keeping them to gain a reward. Instead, the point of the Ten Commandments is to point out when we don't keep them, when we sin. So maybe years ago, I haven't heard it recently, but I'm sure there are many Christians that still have it posted in our courtrooms, and maybe that would be good because then the judge could just point at them and say, the accused person, that's what you didn't do. You didn't follow those. And so they're meant to, again, point out our sin, not for us to try to live by them. So if not the Ten Commandments as the code to live by, then what is our code that we try to live by? Sticking with Paul, this time in chapter 13, the commandments are summed up in this word. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong against a neighbor, and therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. So maybe that's the code that we try to live by. We try to love our neighbor. And besides that, the Ten Commandments, I don't know if I already said this or if you heard it somewhere else, but the Ten Commandments are actually intended not for our benefit, so that we gain some kind of reward by keeping them, eternal life, but instead the Ten Commandments are intended for the benefit of our neighbor. They dictate our behavior so that our neighbor can flourish, can be healthy and whole, and can have a good life. So they limit us and prevent us from taking advantage of our neighbor. So that's their intent and that's their purpose. In Jesus, in the Gospels, maybe we can see Jesus as doing battle with the religious community and with the religious leaders because he's trying to show them that it's not about keeping the rules, it's not about following these laws, instead it's about showing mercy. And so he goes about healing everyone, especially those that were considered unworthy of healing. And he does so often, maybe even on purpose, he does it on the Sabbath, which really makes the religious leaders mad. But his point is that it's not keeping the rules, it's showing mercy. It's loving your neighbor. In this parable that we have put beside the Ten Commandments, the parable of the Good Samaritan, that in Luke is the story that supports the fulfilling of the commandments through love, love God and love your neighbor. The Good Samaritan story supports that. In telling that story, Jesus redefines who is in and who is out, who is acceptable in God's sight and who is not. It's not, as everyone has been teaching and preaching, it's not the people that follow the rules and keep the laws and keep the Ten Commandments. Instead, it's the one who shows mercy, like the Samaritan. And he points out that the rules are not an end in themselves so that we somehow warrant a reward and are deserving of a reward. Instead, they are intended to, instead of us serving them, they are intended to serve us. They are intended to serve us in our relationship, again, for the benefit of our neighbor. So oftentimes we turn it around, right? We try to serve the Ten Commandments. We try to follow them and keep them and uphold them. Instead, they're in service to us and our relationships and for the benefit of our neighbor. So in the parable, the expert in the law asks the kind of the story that surrounds the parable. The expert in the law says, "Who is my neighbor?" After being told that we are to love God and love our neighbor, and actually he's the one that said that, so he knows that. But then he asks, "Who is my neighbor?" And so Jesus tells this story about the Good Samaritan, and then after that he turns it around and he asks the lawyer, who was a neighbor to this injured man? So he turns it around. The question is, who do I have to care about? And Jesus shows him what caring looks like. He says, who do I have to help? And Jesus shows him a picture of someone helping someone else. There's a new documentary on Mr. Rogers. Have you heard of Mr. Rogers? Anybody that's not, wasn't alive whenever he did it, 50s or 60s was his show. Oh, there was a Good Samaritan flashed by. Sorry about that. Did you want to see him again? There he is. All right, there's Mr. Rogers. And apparently, Mr. Rogers approached this television show rather than a means to proclaim his message and to further his agenda. He saw it as a ministry to the children that would watch the show. And actually, he said he got into television because he hated it so much, which seems kind of backwards. He hated, I think, what it did to kids, plopped them in front of the TV. I'm putting these words in his mouth, but if you consider somebody watching TV, they're not doing much. They're just kind of sitting there, a couch potato, we call it, right? And so maybe he didn't like what it was doing to kids, but since kids were doing it, he saw it as an opportunity to nurture them, to tell them how valued they were and how loved they were. And so, again, he saw it as his ministry. He saw the way... I guess his formula was to take all the elements that make for good television, so think for a moment what those are, and he did the exact opposite. So I think what that means is Anne likes old movies, I don't like them because the technology is so bad, right? So I want all the glitz and the glamour and all the technology, and that's part of the entertainment value, right? And so again, putting words in his mouth, I think he stayed away from all of that because he wanted to be more about the message than about the presentation. So think about our ministry along the same lines. And often churches, aren't they? They want the latest technology and they want to, because we want to attract people to us. We want people to come to us and we want to be appealing, and so... So we try to do everything presentation-wise, and maybe we lose sight of the message. So that's a good lesson for us to pay attention to, that it's not what we get, instead it's what we are able to give. That's an important distinction, I think. Trying to apply that maybe a little bit to today, back when Facebook kind of blew up, right, and Mark Zuckerberg, he had to go before Congress and all of that. So I had Ben take me off of Facebook because I wasn't really using it much anyway, and I actually haven't missed it. I haven't pined away for Facebook at all. But what if, using the same principles that Mr. Rogers apparently used, what if I saw it as more ministry, as an opportunity to nurture people through that medium, rather than what I might get out of it? You know, being able to connect with people and show them that I'm with it in the technology age, even though I know we've moved past Facebook, right? Only the old people use Facebook now. But still, if we saw it as a ministry, saw it as how we were reaching out, saw it as how we were nurturing others, rather than focusing on what we get, maybe that would change how we do things, how churches in general do things, instead of trying to be more appealing, trying to be more involved in ministry. So the Good Samaritan parable is, and we're back to the Good Samaritan off of Mr. Rogers. Whoop, not that one. The next one, that guy. There you go. Who is my neighbor is turned around to who is being a neighbor to somebody else. And to be a neighbor is to help somebody to flourish and to be well, to heal and to make whole. So again, think about our ministry. Read an article this week, and I shared it with the staff and some other people, and they said that the main question that the Bible addresses and tries to answer is the question, is love stronger than death? Is love stronger than death? And people come to church with that same question and hoping to hear the answer, that it is true, that love is stronger than death. And the people that keep coming come in the hope and the prayer that that is in fact true. So this parable of the Good Samaritan and hopefully our ministries proclaim that love is stronger than death, that love is stronger than a bunch of robbers who jump a man traveling from Jerusalem to another town and beat him up and take everything and leave him half dead. That love is stronger than that. Love is stronger than the racist comment that you overhear more and more. Love is stronger than hatred. Love is stronger than the strength and the power that tries to take advantage of those who are weak. So that, I think, is our message, and that is our ministry. So should we try to live by the Ten Commandments as our code to live by? Hopefully you agree that a better code is to seek to love God and to love our neighbor, and that will take care of fulfill the Ten Commandments. And that loving of the neighbor is helping them to flourish, is to heal, and is to care for their well-being, to nurture them. And I think the point of all of this, so often the church sees trying to be right with God as making a list of things not to do and then setting out trying not to do them. And then if we identify places that are unsavory and situations and people that we, because they're sinful, we don't want to be anywhere near them. We want to keep ourselves separate because we want to be right with God. And we hope God sees our efforts and is impressed and maybe doesn't see that we don't exactly follow through and aren't successful in what we're trying to do. But Jesus turns that all around and he says it's not about that. It's about something else altogether. It's about being willing to stop and see somebody that is in need and stopping and reaching down and caring for them. That is what impresses God and what God wants to see from his church. And so Jesus says, go and do likewise.